And welcome to the May 18th, 1993, Planning Board meeting of the Town of Cape Elizabeth. The first order of business this evening are the review of the minutes and hopefully the approval of the minutes on the April 20th meeting. Is there any discussion by board members, staff, corrections, comments, changes?
Mr. Edsall?
Judy?
Just a very minor correction on page 5. It's the second paragraph, beginning of the third. I believe where it says bridge is supposed to be brook. Sentence would read, across the brook, they are proposing a 36-inch wide bridge.
Okay, I guess I missed,
second,
which paragraph?
Second paragraph.
Okay.
Third, beginning of third line.
Okay.
Very
across
minor.
The bridge they are proposing. Correct. What should the word be in there?
Brook.
Any other changes? I think we'll just wait briefly while we get our board secretary back. Understand we're not taping. I just mentioned to the board members while we're waiting, if you can try to remember that your microphones are on, try to speak as loudly as clear and clearly as you can into the microphone. We have a history of sometimes late in the meeting, usually sitting back in our chairs, and sometimes the voice falls away. I think we can continue. Are there any other corrections, changes to be made? Seeing none, do I have a motion?
So
Judy?
Moved to approve the minutes.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded with the one change. All those in favor of the approval, raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. Before we start the correspondence, just draw your attention to the tentative planning board schedule. The workshop for the first of June. I would just like to add to maybe those two items that we see, emergency ordinance revisions and technical amendments, that we spend a short time on the sign ordinance, especially for new members, all of us in our packet we have received. Copy of the sign ordinance. I think part of that responsibility is going to be going to the town council, but we should be familiar with that ordinance. Reviewing the correspondence of the past 2 weeks or past month, actually, we have the Environment and Development newsletter, April edition, a letter from our town attorney in reference to the Highland subdivision. Next, a Maine Municipal Association announcement of workshops, and I'd like to urge all members, new and veteran members of the board, to attend these seminars, meetings when you can. Some of these are free, some of them there's a small cost, but I think these are actually free. And usually excellent topics. Fourthly, Threshold to Maine Resource Conservation Development Area newsletter, in the spring of 1993. Memo from the town manager in reference to the emergency ordinance. You may want to just stick that in your packet that goes on to the June workshop. That will be an item that we review at that time. Next, the Twilight Zoning, I like the name of it, workshop. Actually, one's in Standish and one is in Farmington, but the one here in Standish, is, I believe, free also. Next, we have something, when we get letters that go with agenda items, I have to resort them after I go through them. Erosion control workshop, excellent workshop. The sign ordinance, again, should go into your work packet for the workshop. A letter from the Conservation Commission on the Wild Rose subdivision, its comments after, I believe, the site walk. I have the sign ordinance received on the podium this evening. It has a cover of notice to interested residents, and then there's some other material, diagram, and some writing. It's signed by Hilda Cushing Dudley in reference to the Wild Rose subdivision. There's also on the podium tonight a memo from John Swan in reference to the Highlands at Broad Cove, summary of cost of the wetlands restoration, and a faxed copy of something. Put that. I think it's in reference to that. Sometimes faxes don't copy real well. Next on the podium, a letter from Mike Hill, counsel for the town of Cape Elizabeth, writing to Paul Frinsco, in reference to the town of Cape Elizabeth Highlands at Broad Cove, Greater Portland Development, mentioning that the legal and the deed of the conveyance of streets and drainage easements, a recommendation that should be a warranty, not a quitclaim deed. And I believe, lastly, a letter from Peter Greenleaf of Drummond and Drummond to Mrs. Cushing in reference to the Rose Wild Rose subdivision. Not lastly, a notice of another seminar dealing with global warming, an evening of slides and discussion with a number of individuals tomorrow night. Matter of fact, any other correspondence from board members, letters, communications? Okay. First item of old business this evening, we'll start right off with the old business. Beals Ice Cream site plan request by Beals Old Fashioned Ice Cream for a change of use at Fish and Farm Market to an ice cream store located at 300 Ocean House Road. Site plan review, public hearing section 19-2-10. What I'd like to do before we start the public hearing is briefly have the applicant or representative of the applicant come to the podium, introduce yourself, bring us up to speed with any additions, changes, etc., since the last meeting, any submissions, so that the general public can have some idea if they didn't check into the public copy. Good evening.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pete Malia, and I'm here on behalf of Beals. As you know, we are planning to change the Fish and Farm Market at 330 Ocean House Road to Beals Ice Cream Store, and our application was deemed complete at the last meeting. I'd just like to address some of the concerns and comments that the Planning Board had at the last meeting, which I have. I'll just kind of highlight some of the things in my cover letter to you all dated April 29th. The first issue was the septic system, and as far as the septic system is concerned, I think basically I see three issues involving the septic system. One is the ability of the existing system to support our use, and I've included a letter from soil scientist Al Frick dated April 30th stating that the existing disposal bed should be adequate for the modest increase in wastewater generated by our ice cream facility. Second issue involving the septic system is the strength of our wastewater, and I refer you once again to a letter from Al Frick dated April 14th, which states that a takeout stand serving ice cream without food preparation and dishwashing will have an anticipated wastewater strength equal to or less than domestic wastewater. And I'm not sure if I've pointed this out yet, but we don't plan to manufacture any of our ice cream here in Cape Elizabeth. We do all of that at our Pine Point location in Scarborough. So there will not be any manufacturing done here. And a third issue which was raised concerning the septic system was the location of the replacement system. There was a question as to whether it had exceeded the leased area, and we measured it, and it seems to us as though the scale here is 1 inch equals 20 feet, and the scale that Al Frick used was 1 inch equals 50 or 60 feet, 50 feet. And based on that, it seems to us as though the replacement system is located within the leased land. We would be happy to add the replacement system onto this plan as a condition of approval, should you so desire. A second issue was signage, but I'd like to come back to that because we have a sign proposal here, which Scarborough Signs drew up. Another issue was landscaping, and we met with Phil Roberts from Broadway Gardens, and he took a look at the site, and we gave you each a copy of this overlay. We could also add this to the plan if you wanted, but Phil's ideas were to sculpt a 3 to 4 foot mulch bed around parking spaces 4 and 5, and contour it. Let's see, he suggested that we plant rhododendrons, emerald and gold, Euronymus, rosy glow, barberry, and winter gem boxwood. There's 4 planters located in front of the stores. Phil suggested dwarf Alberta spruce and annuals. And the stone planter located in front of the shed, we'd fix that up and plant some Stella d'Oro daylily and Elijah Blue fescue. Those were Phil's suggestions, which we liked. We got a price quote from him, and we would suggest, we would propose to have at least that that work done. The site distances were shot according to incorrect specifications. We had those redone, and the correct site distances are northerly on Ocean House Road is 755 feet. It was, using the previous specification, 713 feet. And southerly, the distance is 1,010 feet. And using the previous specifications, it was 1,015. So there's not much of a change. We did make 15 copies of this. If you would like to receive them, it's by a professional land surveyor from Portland. The lighting was an issue. Our proposed lighting, as described in our April 1st letter to the planning board, had included 4 lights that were not on this plan, and we added those to this overlay. There's one on the shed, and there's one also in the very front of the building. There's 4 150 watt bulbs that were for some reason left off of that, which once again we could add to the master plan itself without much of a problem. Also, I'd like to point out that if we are allowed to have a sign on the front lawn in the right of way, we would also propose, which we mentioned in a previous letter for the April meeting, a 150 watt spotlight on each side of the sign that would be located here on the existing signpost, just to light that up at night. Store closing time was raised. We plan to close at 10 o'clock, and of course, when you open up a small business in any town, you have to kind of play things by ear, so it might change a half an hour, 9:30 or 10:30. As we go along and see what sort of business we're getting there. We also would propose to, right now we're planning on staying open year-round, and that in the winter months, I'm sure would close probably closer to 8 o'clock than 10 o'clock. As far as the ice cream serving area is concerned, we plan to serve from this large building and not from this small shed at all. There's two garage doors in the front wall of this existing wood frame building, and one of them we will just cut out two serving windows, and we will serve ice cream through those two windows. And there's also in between the two garage doors, there's a door where people can come inside, and there's plenty of room inside where we would propose to set up a couple of tables and some chairs and allow people to sit down and eat their ice cream. As far as parking is concerned, the spaces were determined by the previous Fish and Farm Market. We took a look at their parking arrangement, and we combined that with our other stores, which have a similar design in Scarborough and Gorham. And that's basically how we came up with the parking spaces. It was just seemed to be based on reason and space. There are on the plan a couple of areas where our proposed driveway exceeds the existing driveway, and a couple of areas where our proposed driveway comes within the existing driveway, just on the edges here and over here a little bit. And where we come inside of the existing driveway, we would propose to plant grass in that area. Where we exceed the existing driveway, I believe you received a a diagram which indicates how we would handle that areas in which we exceed the existing driveway. We would propose to construct a gravel base there. Back to the signage.
Ms. Malley, I'd just like to make sure you're as brief as possible. The introduction you're doing right now is for the general public, and not to go through in detail all of the items. We've had a chance to read through most of that, and I think once the public hearing is over, if there's a general brief statement you want to make about sign, it's fine. We'll get back to the discussion more in detail as the board comes in.
Okay. Anything else then?
Okay. Anything else?
No.
Okay. Very good. Just in general for the public hearing, I will read back through the guidelines for public hearings. Members of the public wishing to address the board concerning an agenda item shall wait until the chairman asks for a public comment. When recognized by the chair, the person shall state his or her name and address in an audible tone for the record. The person shall limit his or her remarks to the issue under discussion. That's pretty straightforward. And at this time, I'll open the public hearing for any comments by the public in reference to this agenda item. Are there any members of the public who would like to speak? Seeing and hearing none, I'll close the public hearing and ask the applicant to return to the podium. We sometimes have some very exciting public hearings. And also open it up to the board for discussion. I think everybody's had a chance to review the material and open it up for general discussion and questions. Judy, you look like you'd like to lead.
No.
Stephen?
I just have one question for Maureen. Since they're planning on having tables inside, does that change anything at all as far as that become now a restaurant as opposed to a takeout business?
Whether or not they have tables inside it, I think would have most affected whether or not they were in fact a change of use. And that the code enforcement officer has determined a while ago that they were enough of a change of use that they would require site plan review. My understanding has been early on that there was discussion about having tables inside. My assumption is that the estimate of parking will also be based on whether or not there are tables inside, and that also the work that's been done on the capacity of the cemetery system was done with the assumption on the applicant's part that there were going to be tables and some service.
Why doesn't this need zoning board approval?
Why doesn't this need zoning board approval?
A restaurant would.
I'd have to talk to the code enforcement officer. My understanding is that this just needed site plan approval. Perhaps the applicant could tell us whether it was clearly understood by the code enforcement officer that there were going to be some tables inside.
I would just add to that, what time did you decide that you would have, and this is the first time I've heard that you had an interest in serving inside the buildings for sit-down?
Actually, we've basically had it in mind all along, but I guess this is the first time it's come up. It's just only because there's enough space inside to do it, and it would be nice for people to come in and sit down. I wasn't aware of any possible restaurant issues, actually. Have you discussed?
Would there be any public restrooms?
Would there be access to a public restroom?
Restrooms in there, but we don't have the inside to get that. They can walk in and be served and then go up.
Yeah, it appears as though the interior seating is going to raise some issues that we hadn't anticipated, so we would probably be prepared to dispose of that idea. We would allow people to walk in, get their ice cream, and walk out, and we wouldn't provide seating, and therefore we wouldn't have to provide a public restroom.
Okay. Any other questions, Steve?
All set.
All set. Tom?
Just a couple. I remember somewhere in the literature,
some comment regarding the septic system and whether or not it's has been deemed suitable for year-round use or has a capacity where now it's a seasonal use. What is the response to that issue?
Al Frick did his studies based on, you know more about this, and I'm going to turn this over to Pete Malia Sr., who has had more to do with this than I did.
Pete Malia Sr., I don't see the literature here, but Al Frick and I have been talking, and he did his study on the basis of gallons per day, and there's no distinction made whether it's for one day, 60 days, 6 months, 12 months. I checked with him again today, and I checked with Ernie McBain, and we're told that the rating that we have on that system will support year-round use.
Okay. I'll say from your material, Al Frick based it on a seasonal use of your Gorham location over the last 2 years.
He took a look at the Gorham store to see what we were using.
Right, and converted that into gallons per day. Exactly.
Then he took a look at
cubic feet.
Reduced it to gallons per day.
Right, but based on seasonal use.
I think it was just the system design.
Well, all I'm saying is your Gorham location is a seasonal use, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
What do you anticipate doing here during the winter? Do you anticipate selling ice cream or?
Yes.
And what sort of ice cream service do you anticipate having during the winter?
Probably just keep it plowed and have the same sort of walk-up, take-out type service.
Do you do that in any other community currently?
Just Portland and Raymond, two of our four stores.
And people actually do go to the walk-up window in the wintertime?
The Portland store doesn't have a walk-up window. That's walk inside, get served, and walk out. And in Cape, people could also walk inside, get served, and walk out. In Raymond, they have a walk-up window, and they also are able to walk inside. And Raymond also provides coffee, muffins, and donuts, and things of that nature in the morning. And I'm not sure. I'm sure if we did plan to expand into that sort of service, and we'd probably have to come back here again and and get approval for that, but we don't plan to right now.
Is that indeed the case, Maureen? It's sort of like the gas station that turns into a restaurant over a couple of weeks and nobody notices the transition. What we're approving is an ice cream stand. It sounds to me like we're headed toward a light breakfast center. And I'm particularly suspicious since they're talking about walk-up ice cream in the middle of the winter in Cape Elizabeth. If those numbers can work, I ought to be in the business.
I guess I'm a little concerned. In my many meetings with the applicant, there have been discussions about having tables inside. And in terms of the use of the property, that makes a lot of sense to me. But I'm not sure that that has been conveyed to the code enforcement officer.
I think the difficult area for the planning board is we just need to know what it is that's before us in terms of an application. Because the quintessential question that always comes to haunt us is, how in the world did that ever get approved as a restaurant? And we would like you to be blunt and forthcoming with whatever ideas you have about using the property. There's no problem with using the property as such. As a member of the Town Center Committee, we're interested in encouraging business development in the Town Center, so there's nothing non-compatible with that. But as a planning board member approving a site plan for a change of use, it gives me a better understanding knowing whether I'm going to see cars lined up getting ice cream cones on a seasonal basis or whether I anticipate seeing contractor trucks parked out front every single morning getting donuts and coffee throughout the year. Again, which I don't have a problem with as long as I know that in advance and as long as I know that that's what's being approved. It to me seems quite unclear, particularly with the notion of tables inside and the need for heating and other building improvements in order to carry on such a business during the winter time, that my concern is that we're going to lose hold of this application, that will end up in the code enforcement office, and you'll come back to the code enforcement officer and get a building permit for something that we really have not approved as part of a site plan review for a change of use. So my only comment is, all I see in front of me tonight is an ice cream takeout service, and to the best of my knowledge, it was seasonal, and I'm willing to approve the application based on that. Otherwise, I'd like an opinion from the code enforcement officer, given the condition of the building, the utilities, and so forth, whether what you're proposing as an alternative is viable on that property.
Okay, what we're proposing is an ice cream takeout stand. Walk up and take out at the window, or walk inside and get served from a counter and walk out with it year-round. And I think you're picturing people freezing out in the snow waiting in line to get to the window, but they'll have the opportunity to walk inside. It'll be heated inside. They'll be able to get their ice cream and be served from a counter inside, and they won't have to stand outside and freeze. And they do that in Raymond. They sell quite a bit of ice cream in the winter on 302. And that is what we are proposing, and that's it right now.
Has a plan been submitted to the code enforcement officer indicating the interior improvements to either building for a counter and sit-down area?
No, we haven't been made aware of the need to do that. We did provide, in I think the last meeting or the one before, a little diagram of the front of the building where we proposed to cut in the windows to serve the ice cream out the windows, but we haven't submitted any sort of interior design because we just haven't been asked to.
In terms, I recall, were there plans, revised plans submitted? I didn't think so. I have from the previous meeting, and I apologize for not being at the last meeting, but the parallel parking spaces are not dimensioned either in width or length. Using the graphic scale from the plan, it appears as though they're 18 feet long, which probably is not going to be enough for, if you have three of those spaces all in use at the same time, I doubt that you can get people in and out of those with an 18-foot space. I would suggest that either we talk to either your engineer or the town engineer, get together. It seemed to me that 20 or 22 feet would be more appropriate. As an individual space, it doesn't sound like much, but when you add those additional dimensions to three spaces, you're working your way closer to the road or closer to the building.
Okay, we could possibly cut those three spaces down to two if need be, I'm sure. There's plenty of spaces, so I don't think that would be much of a problem.
Has there been any discussion about the designation of parking areas, how that's going to be delineated on the ground?
I'm not sure, but at our other locations, we usually set up the concrete
wheel stops
at the end of the spaces here. And,
is that what's implied on these plans, that line that's at the head of each parking stall? There's a single line there. I would interpret that to be a wheel stop.
I would think so, yes.
That's the extent of my comments.
Okay. I need to make a comment because I'm afraid that some of what we're going through gets interpreted that the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board is dragging their feet when or going through this in a very slow manner. I think the issue is that from the beginning the application came to us with a minimal amount of information. As we ask more questions, you tend to give us more information from the podium, which is not the way the process works. It leads us only to confusion, so more questions come up. And we sort of meander through a site plan process that is frustrating for this board. I'm sure it's frustrating for you to have us constantly ask questions. The procedure typically is that you come to us with a solid plan saying this is what Beale's old-fashioned ice cream wants to do, and we take a look at it. I just felt that I need to say that. I don't know if the other board members feel that way, but I still don't know what I'm shooting at here for an application. I feel like we've got this moving target with seasonal versus year-round use, inside use versus outside use, the lighting, the signage, all are moving targets. And again, I'm afraid this is going to be interpreted that the planning board doesn't want new downtown business. That, at least from my point of view, and I know Tom just said, his point of view is not the way we look at this. But you just need to understand this is a frustrating process when we seem to have a moving target for an application. I'll yield to some more questions. Judy?
I would have prefaced my remarks saying the same thing for something that's been kind of on the books, as it were, since October of last year. It seems very ill-prepared. I'm surprised, too, that seating might be proposed. I certainly feel before I could approve this, the plans would need to be revised, and if there's any confusion, perhaps sit with our town planner to find out how we generally like to see things such as lighting and signage and landscaping on the plans, how cross-sections are typically presented. Going through my past notes, I saw that the town engineer had quite a few comments that I don't think have all been addressed. He had also raised the issue of whether a traffic impact study was appropriate. Now that we may be moving closer toward a restaurant, I wonder if that's appropriate. I really question whether the Board of Zoning Appeals needs to look at this. I feel uncomfortable with the number of parking spaces, as I said last time, and how they were determined. And the only thing I can see in the zoning ordinance says that for unspecified uses, the Board of Zoning Appeals needs to specify the number of spaces. There was an issue raised, this is very minor, about how the lessee appears to be different than the applicant, and that has still not been clarified, at least not for us. Let's see. I would like on the next time we see a plan, the use of the shed to be clarified, and if that would only be for storage or some non-business use, that would be fine. I certainly would want to know if interior seating is proposed now. The plan, you had asked if we would want to see if the replacement system does fit on the leased area, and you would show it on the plan. I certainly would want to see that so we could verify, because we have a proposed motion to consider which included numerous conditions, but what catches my eye, if any one of those conditions couldn't be met, where does that leave us with an approved plan that maybe has a replacement septic system not on that lot? If there's any confusion on your part, what the planning board would like to see. I really would recommend that you sit down with our planner, who could probably pull out previous plans of other submittals. Again, I'm not anti-business downtown either, but the last thing we dealt with this in an area was a proposed fitness center that never was built. But if you talk to anyone about that, we did look at a lot of issues, and the plans ended up being much more detailed than what we're looking at right now.
As I understand it, if any of the conditions are met, are not met, then there is no approval.
Well, what happens, though, is the decision is the board's to approve a project. And when we're not really sure what we're approving, we throw the decisions on staff's shoulders. And they have to make the calls that really they have no charge or the responsibility and do not want that responsibility. And that's why we're here. So until you can come before us and tell us exactly what you want, and then maybe we'll quibble or absolutely agree with you. But I really cannot see from looking at your plans and your overlays and your attachments what we're finally being asked to approve.
I just explained that it's a building where you can walk up to two windows, buy some ice cream, go back to your car, or you can walk inside to a counter, buy some ice cream, and go back to your car. I don't think we ever said it would be seasonal, and I don't think seating or interior design ever came up, because it's never come up until now. I never had any indication that we would have to submit any sort of interior plan.
Well,
I didn't know seating would be a problem.
I'm sure if you sit down both with the
and
town planner.
Now that I do know, I've decided to withdraw the suggestion that we have seating.
I don't want to get into a lot of issues right now, but I think if you sit down with the town planner and the code enforcement officer, talk about the things you've considered, they will be very happy to tell you if you're considering X, that what you have to do, because they certainly do know that. And then when you come back before us, if that's indeed what happens tonight, that we'll all be clear on the proposal and staff would have a clearer recommendation for board action.
Don?
Yeah, I don't see much difference in the time that it would take in order for, we have in front of us seven or probably eight or nine items now that would be conditions of approval that would require amendments to a plan. I don't see much time difference between developing those amendments and going to the code enforcement officer and getting started with the site improvements versus making those changes. Your understanding, the code enforcement officer, planning and planning board, all understanding what it is we're approving and having that presented to us at the June meeting. Again, I think the list is quite comprehensive and could be easily done just by checking off the items that we're asking for. As an example, there's a question in our application, in our materials, that suggests adding a note to the plans that the use is seasonal and define the months of operation. It's clear from that comment that nobody understood this to be anything but a seasonal use.
I don't know how you got that impression.
Well, I guess our understanding is, or was, that this was ice cream sales at a walk-up window, which very much implies seasonal use, particularly in Cape Elizabeth. We already have a similar situation further out Route 77. That's a seasonal use. There was no mention of coffee or donuts. Again, we're not talking about McDonald's here or anything that drastic, but we just need to have a common understanding of what it is that you're proposing to do. And I think that you should put in writing, specifically as you stated tonight, that this is what you want, and the code enforcement officer can make a determination based on that, what he needs for plans and what has to be provided for public accommodation, including toilets.
I think a whole spectrum of questions come up with year-round use. I mean, we don't even know that the building has a heating system that will provide for that type of use. But the whole other set of issues come up in the site plan review when we deal with a different scope of use than what we were supplied information about. I think we did make some assumptions, but it certainly was not proposed to us as a year-round ice cream stand. Perhaps we made a wrong assumption. I'll go back to my original point that we were provided with a minimum amount of information, and all of these items tend to fall out as we've proceeded. I continue to have problems with the septic system. The septic system that is existing, according to Mr. Frick, supports a use of about 45 gallons a day. It's a 10 by 15 bed. The replacement system is based on 220 gallons. Your use in Gorham, which you're proposing half the use, the just one dipper well versus a double dipper well, and there's an assumption made that half the volume will be used, uses about 200 gallons a day. We've got a real discrepancy in what that use can provide. As just one board member, I have no intent on voting favorably on this to promote a replacement system. Public sewer is 240 feet away. As one board member, I think it should be a condition of approval that upon failure of the existing system that the site is hooked up to public sewer. With that in mind, I don't even want to go into the issues of whether Mr. Frick's study on the quality of the wastewater or whatever it is. I just think in our downtown area, this planning board should not be promoting a subsurface septic system in the center of our town, especially when sewer is 240 feet away. At this time, because we don't seem to be aiming at any, well, I'll leave it up to the consensus of the board. Where do you think that we're aiming toward, and where would you like to proceed to? Okay. It's a good suggestion. Any final questions? I think if it's an issue that the Beal application comes back to this board, that we want as a board to be able to make sure that they understand exactly what we're looking for, and that it's very clear to them, not necessarily the format, but the scope of information. So I guess I'd ask from the board members, both specifically, if you have further questions, and specifically, any items that you'd like to see more defined when the application returns, if that's the ruling. Judy?
Aside from the general remarks I made before, I would certainly want to see all lighting on there, including the proposed floods. I would like to see the location of all signs determined on the ground, be those traffic signage, handicap signage, signs on the building itself, if they're, give us an indication if they're little signs showing takeout and so forth. Certainly want to see the location and size and design of the sign that's currently proposed for the right-of-way. I'd like to see what the status is of getting that approved in the right-of-way. If not, I'd like to see the location, the alternate location shown on the plan where the sign would be located. Landscaping definitely on the plan, and the town planner can go over the format that usually is in with specifying the number of plants and the size and when they'll be planted. The whole parking issue clarified with respect to number of spaces needed if the Board of Zoning Approval needs to approve those, the size of the parking places Mr. Emery raised. And I still have the general questions that our town engineer raised, so I think the applicant should address those, as well as a clear statement of exactly what is being proposed
I think
in writing.
Just so it's specific, that you're referring to the April 12th letter from T.Y. Lynn?
And I also looked at one that was dated October 31st, okay. of 92.
Okay.
On the wastewater, I was unclear on your remarks that we should be hooked up to the sewer rather than the existing system.
That's right. I just think that when public sewer is available that close to the site, I realize it's not abutting the leased area, but is in close proximity, if not abutting the fee simple owner of the parcel, I'd say it's ludicrous for this planning board to approve a subsurface septic system in what is our downtown when sewer is available. What I decided to do is just circumvent the discussion of butterfat, et cetera, in a septic system and the effect that it has on that, whether I agree with Mr. Frick or not, and simply say when the existing system, when the existing leach field handles, in his estimation, 45 gallons per day, fails, that this site, regardless of the use, whether it's Bill's Ice Cream or whatever the use comes before him, it would be my opinion as one board member that it should be hooked up to public sewer.
Steve, in which Tom. Case you're asking for a letter from the Public Works Director regarding the ability
I'll to yield connect. To Maureen, but I'm not sure that it requires a letter. Perhaps it does. I think the issue that would come up is if there is capacity available at the time that action may come into place. And that's always an issue.
Well, I guess we already have one anyway.
Any other questions? Certainly the associate members, if you have questions or comments, welcome to chime in. Anything? Questions? Okay. Stephen.
When you come back, is it going to be perfectly clear as to what is proposed for the site? Is it going to be just a takeout ice cream stand, or is it going to evolve into something else? A donut and coffee shop that sells Christmas trees during Christmas time, pumpkins during Thanksgiving, and what have you. I'd just like to have that very clear.
If we did start off as what I have proposed tonight, just a place to get ice cream, say we started off as that, then if we did want to expand into other service areas, I would think that we'd have to come back and receive permission to do that. So
I think maybe Maureen can help us there.
Another approach that the board may be more comfortable with would be to think about what you would like to do in the future right now. And what you could do is set up a phased plan where you get approval for what you consider to be your ultimate use of the site. And you may start in just as takeout ice cream and may decide over time to put some tables in. And if you come in with a full plan now, say phased, once you decide to put the tables in, you don't have to come back to the board. Once you decide to expand to other types of things, as long as it's included in the original approval, you don't have to make another trip back here.
I think just as a word of advice, when you return and submit your information by the deadline, don't come before the board and give us substantial information in addition to what was already submitted. We read through a lot of information prior to these. We typically get our packet of information on Thursday night before this meeting. Gives us a fairly sufficient amount of time to read, but to add substantive issues after or at the meeting, 90% of the time is just simply going to slow your process down. If you can get all of your substantive information to us by the deadline, that's a real big help.
I think there's one other point to be made here, that contrary to what Maureen just said, if you were to start out strictly as an ice cream stand, I don't know that there's anything in the ordinance that would require you to come back to sell donuts or to come back to sell Christmas trees or to do all of those other things, nor if you were to go from seasonal to year-round use. I don't believe that there's anything that you may or may not have to come back before the board. As a board member, I don't know whether you would or not, but I would certainly, in approving this application, want to know that information prior to the approval. Otherwise, I would place a condition of approval that is specifically for X, Y, or Z, whatever that would happen to be at the time we're voting on the application.
Frankly, if we're not required to come back to get approval for additional uses, I don't see why we should have to reveal our plans for the future, especially since as a small business owner, you often don't know your plans for the future. you often don't know whether or not you're going to be able to stay open during the winter, or how late you're going to stay open, or what sort of foods are going to be successful there. And it's almost a crapshoot sometimes to predict what's going to go at one place and at another place. But.
On the other hand, I think Maureen's comment is a good one, that if you find yourself, if you have any indications from your other business experience that, as you have described, having tables inside works well, and it's particularly necessary in this climate to have a winter business, that you want to be sure what you have for a site and what you're leasing can accommodate that. Otherwise, you're going to be in a lease situation that won't accommodate it. When I said I didn't know, you may in fact have to come back to the board, and I'd hate to see you in that situation in the middle of operating a business and have to come back to the board and find something in that process that didn't allow you to expand the business or to do whatever it is you wanted to at that time. We're talking about 6 months, a year and a half out into the future. We're not talking about 5-year plans and 10-year plans here.
Any other comments? If not, do I hear a
one question from Maureen. Can you ascertain whether or not anything else is necessary from either the Zoning Board of Appeals or from Ernie, just to make sure that we're comfortable with where we are?
Just to let the board know how applications get to you. What typically happens is someone comes into the building inspector's office and says, I want to do X. And at that point, the code enforcement officer makes a determination whether they need to get a building permit, whether they need some other kind of permit, or whether they need to go to the planning board or to the zoning board. So he's the one that makes that determination. And to be quite honest, the reason I would suggest that the applicant get everything on the plans now is that under our existing zoning, it's very sensitive to any slight change of use. And when someone, for example, may expand their hours of operation from lunch to breakfast, that can be considered an expansion of use that would have to come back to the planning board. On the other hand, the seasonal selling of trees is something that he doesn't consider an expansion of use because it's a seasonal operation. So under our existing zoning, it's very sensitive. And in order to avoid any delays in wanting to have that flexibility, you may want to bring it on your plans right now. So I can't tell you how much has to go to the zoning board. I need a better idea of what the code enforcement officer's understanding of what this operation was.
Any other comments or questions?
Steve?
Yes, Tom.
Just to be very reasonable and realistic here, there's a season, a summer season right at the doorstep now. I don't have a specific interest in seeing this applicant being brought into a zoning board process. An appeals board process to determine the number of parking spaces. If there's a reasonable way of determining from if they want to be a restaurant from restaurant or by documenting the number of employees and other ways of doing it, I'm, as a board member, very willing to listen to that without having to have it filtered through the appeals board first, as long as that's all right with Ernie in the process. If they end up back before the appeals board, I don't think they're going to be selling ice cream this summer.
Okay. Any other comments? Questions?
Frankly, I'm not sure if we're going to be selling ice cream at all because I understand the role of the planning board here. We have a beautiful town in Cape Elizabeth, and we want to keep it that way. But when you have a vacant storefront with it all set up, for a nice business, I think we just keep running into one more thing after another. I'm back here tonight. We're talking about interior design. We're talking about restaurant issues. We're talking about having to be hooked up to a sewer after we hired a soil scientist to do all the replacement sewer septic system work. And actually, way back in the beginning, when I did go to ask for some sample plans, I was shown plans for Inn by the Sea, which were beautiful, but we just do not have the resources to produce plans like that, and I don't think we have the resources to go any further. I apologize to the good people of Cape Elizabeth, but you'll have to come to Gorham, I think. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
As I said in my comments prior, I was afraid that this would get thrown back in our laps as if we were deviating from and slowing up a process. I hope the board members at least understand where we're coming from, and our responsibilities for the town. Do I hear any motion before the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'll propose the following order for the board to consider. Be it ordered that the request of Beals Old Fashioned Ice Cream for site plan approval of a change of use from a farm and fish market to an ice cream store located at 330 Ocean House Road be tabled to the regular June 1993 Planning Board meeting.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. We certainly invite you back for a regular June meeting. Next order of business is the Wild Rose subdivision, request by the Ragosa Corporation for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit and public access waiver for the Wild Rose Path subdivision, a five-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Ocean House Road and Spurwink Avenue. Public hearing, section 16-2-3, section 19-3-9, section 19-4-2B. Mr. Parkhurst.
Mr. Chairman, due to a possible conflict, I ask that I be excused for the Wild Rose subdivision review and also, as in the past, for the Highland subdivision amendments.
So Mr. Parkhurst is asking to be excused for two agenda items in a row, is that correct? Both of those, just for the record, Mr. Parkhurst has been excused for previously. The explanation was given in both cases. Are there any questions by the board members as to why? Next, I have to excuse myself. I have an open contract with Mr. Weinschenk on the issue of the Wild Rose subdivision, so I have to excuse myself for participation here. We're lucky this evening to have Mr. Emery and certainly more members than we had last time. I'll be back after this agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just so there's absolutely everything's on the table, I know the consulting engineer, Mr. Greer. Mr. Greer has had a contract with our firm for the past several months regarding a middle school expansion. I have no financial interest in that relationship. As far as I know, the relationship is now terminated, so there's no relationship between the vice chair or any member of the applicant's team. With that, what we'd like to do, welcome the applicant, and I assume Mr. Greer will be representing the applicant, is first have a brief overview of the project, and particularly any changes or any comments that have come up with previous meetings and the site walk, if you would address those, and then we'll open the application for public hearing. Again, it's minor subdivision, wetland alteration, and public access waiver. Tom?
Thank you very much.
Excuse me. I think I have to appoint some acting members here. I'll appoint Mr. Wilcox and Mr. Cotter as acting members.
Mr. Wilcox is a
former. Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Cotter and Mr. Marvin. It's been a few meetings.
Thank you very much.
Go ahead, Tom.
My name is Tom Greer from Pinkham & Greer. I'm a principal in the firm. We are completing the civil engineering portion of this project, and what I'll do is give you a brief overview of the site. The site is approximately 4 acres located on Route 77. This is a blow-up of the USGS map to give you an overall picture of it. This is Route 77 that comes down through here. We are located at the very low end of a very large watershed. This is a drainage map that we've used as part of the overall project, and any questions on drainage, I can go back to this drawing. It is approximately 3 acres out of a 300-acre watershed, so we're approximately 1% of that. This drawing is the color-up of the subdivision drawing showing the five lots. We have three lots in the front that are in the area of 21,000 to 25,000 square feet in size. The two lots going away from Ocean House Road are slightly larger. Those are approximately 1 acre in size for the total site area of 4 acres. To the north is the Church of the Latter-day Saints, and to the south is a horse farm, which at the site walk we went up through that area. The project is designed with a private way going into the site that is 20 feet in width, going down a 30-foot right-of-way. One of the issues that has been brought up is that we are asking under the cluster subdivision ordinance that the width of the right-of-way be reduced from 50 feet down to 30 feet. That allows us to put some fences along the right-of-way, which are will have roses planted adjacent to them. The concept is that this subdivision will use those fences and the rose plantings to create a very quaint and nice neighborhood. Leaving the fences at the 30-foot width at the edge of the right-of-way creates the proper scale to the subdivision, where we have 5 homes located in the subdivision. We have looked at moving those fences back to the 50-foot width, and you just don't get the same feeling. It's not the same design concept that we have at the 30-foot width, and that's what we're proposing to do. Because of other issues associated with the customary subdivisions, we are adding, for the most part, a 10-foot-wide easement behind the fence that will allow for any drainage or utility construction that may have to occur along those areas, which again will function as the normal right-of-way of a standard road. The overall zone that we are in is a residential C subdivision zone. There are 2 overlay zones that occur as well. The back portion of the site, highlighted here in the back, is a wetland under the Cape Elizabeth ordinance and is a resource protection area 2, RP2. Also across the back of the site is Trout Brook, and reviewing it with the code enforcement officer, Trout Brook falls under the shoreland zone, requiring a 75-foot setback from that area. So in the back, you actually have the 2 overlapping zones. We are proposing to keep a 25-foot buffer from the wetland boundary, which will be protected with a silt fence to ensure that we don't encroach upon it. And we're also pulling envelopes, building envelopes, back from the stream, the 75 feet, in compliance with the shoreland ordinance. The sewer service, wastewater service for this site has both on-site systems and public sewer. There is a public sewer in Ocean House Road, and we are proposing 2 connections for the 2 front lots to Ocean House Road. Since the site walk, we are proposing to add a note to the drawings that will, in effect, say that those locations will be determined in the field to miss any of the larger vegetation that is along Ocean House Road. There are a few smaller trees and some bushes along here, and we'll pick a location that doesn't cut down any trees greater than 3 inches in diameter. The 3 lots, 3, 4, and 5 in the back, which I've highlighted here in pink, will have individual wastewater on-site septic systems for those. The road will be served by public water as well, and we'll have overhead power. I think that gives you a brief overview of the project. Since the site walk, we would not meet the submittal deadlines for new information to the board. So what we've added here and highlighted in orange is the general location of a path that was reviewed with the Conservation Commission during the site walk. And again, that will be part of the final package. And what we're proposing is that the grantor, along with the Conservation Commission, locate a path approximately in this location and be able to improve it so that you can walk from down Wild Rose Path through the pedestrian easement and then along the wetland boundary, again fitting into the greenbelt concept of the town of Cape Elizabeth. The improvements that we're looking for, that the Conservation Commission is looking for through the wetland area, are very minor. They're looking to do some tree trimming, essentially create a path where you can walk through without tripping over trees and having to climb through brush, but yet not really disturb any of the overstory and miss any of the larger trees that are in this wetland area, this forested wetland. I think that covers most of the issues that we had talked about during the site walk, as well as an overall view. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
We'll be turning this over to a public hearing, but I want to understand, did you say that you're going to have a public access or public easement along the roadway?
Yes, and that has been written into the public access, and we'll be proposing, I have the...
You'll be adding that to the plan?
Yes.
Okay.
What we've done is change the language so that it reads, let me see if I can find it, will be depicted as Wild Rose Path and lots 4 and 5 on the plan, so that we've actually referred to Wild Rose Path in the public access easement.
Thank you. At this time, I'll open the meeting to a public hearing, and if there's any members from the public that would like to speak regarding this project, please come forward and state your name and address. Is there anyone from the public who would like to speak?
Good evening. I am Hilda Dudley of Walnut Hills Stables, and greetings to all members. I have, I'm sure, so many reservations on this project that affects a very big development that I started. So I'm saying, who is in my corner? We of Walnut Hills Stables, I think I'll put my glasses on. It will help. You have some literature already there, but it is faint. We of Walnut Hill Stables are fighting to save our horse farm. Before I speak on the proposed development of Mr. Weinschenk, I would like to speak about our horse farm that will be affected by this project. For the past summer, we had realtors showing the land. In some cases, they were including our property as part of their project, telling people, the farm is going, farm is history, do not worry. As to next door, prior to the true sale of the property, large equipment was used to cut and clear trees from Dr. Virgilio's property. Workers told us this property was owned by Mr. Weinstein and all permits had been given from the town. The equipment in use was far too big to just do soil testing. I was told they were making the road. This is the same location as shown to me last week on their charts. Yes, the horse farm is in jeopardy. I have protected Dr. Virgilio's sale of his land. I called Jim McFarlane as soon as I saw the sign next door and gave a deposit to assure the owner I was sincere in purchasing the property, since the price had been greatly reduced, as was quoted to me in the past. I was told I had the second option, as Mr. Weintank had the first option, subject to his ability to have the town's permit for subdivision for 5 or 6 houses. I have stayed in Dr. Vizzolo's corner. The deposit is still held by his real estate agent. The price is quoted to me is as same as to others, as far as I know. This spring, Dr. Virgilio informed the stable, as well as me in person, that the land was available for me to own, as Mr. Weinschenk had over a year to make up his mind. Now I see that Mr. Weinschenk is back in the picture, and I do not know his plans. At our stable, we house top-grade horses, some in the $50,000 valuation. These are not hack horses, race horses, trail horses. These are American saddlebreds, which are bred for showing, high showing, and high-stepping and high-spirited horses. The location of the new barn was carefully selected to be built on the backside of the property to avoid traffic sounds, fumes, dogs, and people. It is on ledge. Our horses are vet-checked monthly, vaccinated yearly, worm quarterly, bedded ankle-deep with pine shavings daily, droppings removed at all times. Food is selected for proper nourishment, select hay from cultured fields. They are trimmed, brushed, and shaved, gentlemen, and bathed with soft music, gives a well-controlled atmosphere. I am pleased to report two of Tina's horses with her, as the rider is once again a national winner. I included pictures of this award, which will be presented next month to her. Now let us
Excuse
look.
Me, ma'am. This is, it seems to me as though you're going on off on a tangent here. What we're looking for is comments that are specifically related to the project. We all know that would you get specifically to those comments, please?
My next statement is, now let's look at Mr. Weintank's corner and his subdivision with five houses, less or more, on about 4 acres. I would believe 1.5 acres would not be buildable. A working horse farm will make a very poor neighbor. There is proof of other farms in the area that if it is of any help to them, I would gladly present the names of the farms that have been operated. The farmers have sold some of their land, some of the pasture, and the next thing they know, the barn and that end of the program is eliminated because the new people that move in as residents are objecting to having a farm next to them. I have reviewed many situations, and again, I will further that for you at a later time. It is difficult to remember the farm came first. You get what you see, but what you wanted to see, not so. After the houses are sold, the problems become ours and the new owners. What permission promises will Mr. Weintank give to the buyers? Will it be the same promises he might give to the stable? Let us look at the situation on the needed protection our stable must have from Mr. Weintank's project. The developer must place a proper buffer around his area that abuts our farmland. The wall, a wall of solid fencing, must be carried with the sale of the new homeowners. My attorney will speak on that. Trees and bushes are not an acceptable buffer. Plus, some will be removed so that building replacing the present big ones will not be proper buffing for your property. One, prior to any further work, we must know about the plans on blasting. When we built the barn, we called in what I consider an outstanding authority on blasting, Mr. Jim Murray. And we have a great deal of rock and ledge, and he advised absolutely at that time when he was called in, he could not recommend blasting because of the amount of ledge that the barn sits on and the rest of the property, including the main farmhouse. We are planning to arrange a meeting with our expert on this and review Mr. Weintank's plans as related to our land. This is a must. Prior to any further work, we must have a solid buffer wall in place. The same type is used by the highways on a turnpike. The wall fence is made of pressure-treated wood and is grooved. The height will be high because they are on the very low side of the property, abutting us. I have viewed other areas as to protecting residents' property from the site, sounds and fumes. And the fenced wall is good. You may view such a fence at Vernon, Connecticut. So they put one in place there that has been very serviceable. When it comes to the workers, because the buffer perhaps is not installed or for any reason that we have a problem controlling the horses due to the workers' action, the workers must stop. until we can control or remove the problem. They did not do this the last time they were working on the property. The men just laughed as the horses reared. We've got to avoid that. Blasting cannot be as it was ruled when the state did the sewage, generally accepted blasting guidelines and requirements. We at the farm was damaged during the sewer program and was not repaired. We need a postponement so that the stable can meet with the builder of the barn and can meet with the owner of the barn as it is leased, and they have not been given sufficient time to be notified as to what might take place with any attempt to blasting on the ledge. Learn what plans are for the land. This must be available to both the builder of the farm as well as the owner and well as ourselves. The horses will need to be relocated while such blasting is being done, not at our cost. Yes, my horse farm is in jeopardy, as well as I feel that it's most tragic to lose another piece of farmland that could be pastured, not housed. Dr. Virgilio will not lose his sale. How I guess the town maybe would lose some taxes from the new houses. I'm not looking for enforcement or non-enforcement to be regulation. I'm referring to Peter Greenleaf's letter. I'm looking for the removal of the many known problems the stable is destined to incur with the subdivision and public way walkway as abutters. I'm fighting for the best use of the land, both my working horse farm and the land that abuts us. I press you deny the permit for this development. We need to have the truth and the facts as to what the development of Mr. Weinchak is. Please be in my corner. Respectfully submitted, Hilda Dudley. And I would like to look at and ask a question. If the walkway is going here, what is going to protect the people from then coming on our property and Mr. Maxwell's garden? Are they going to propose? That's got to come to a dead end, because you're going to have people da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and they're going to be in the truck farm in my pasture. And incidentally, we've had people tell us as they walked in our pasture, that's the site they picked when they had lunch with Mr. Weinchak. So we need to know the truth, what is going on, and how they're going to handle things before the development, not afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you. I just have one question for you. You stated, I believe, that the barn is owned by somebody else, or you lease it to somebody else?
I lease it. It's a, Telmark is the leaser. It's not paid for. And they are concerned.
Let me just back up a minute.
Yes.
You lease the barn to one entity?
I lease from the owner.
Are you the owner of the property?
I will be when I pay for it.
No. Do you own the White House?
Yes.
And somebody else built the barn and you lease it from them?
No. Oh, it's a Martin barn. You do not own it. Agway, Martin owns the building, and they put it up. And then you pay Telmark. It's their barn, and they're concerned, as Mr. Martin is. He lives incidentally here at the Cape. He was the builder. That it has got to be thoroughly studied because of the ledge. The barn is built on the same ledge that they are talking about blasting.
The horses that are stabled in the barn, are the stabling charges are paid to you?
They're my horses. Most of them are all mine.
Your horses,
no.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Members of the board, my name is Alan Ritzine. I'm a lawyer, and I'm just here to address two quick issues on behalf of Mrs. Dudley.
How do you spell your last name, please?
H-R-Y-C-A-Y. Just to clarify that last point, Mrs. Dudley does own the real estate where the barn is located and is, in essence, has a lease option to purchase, just like you would for an automobile. When you make your final lease payment, then you become the owner, and she will own it outright. The two issues that I wish to address relate to any potential restrictions and or buffers that benefit her property. I would want, so that she is protected in the future when the developer is no longer in the picture, either have to have those included in the declaration for the owners association or in a recorded subdivision plan so that she would have the ability to enforce those in the future. The second issue that I would like to address is the financial ability of the applicant in this matter. In reviewing the file, I see that the applicant is a corporation of which Peter Greenleaf is the sole shareholder. And my understanding is the town manager has met with Mr. Greenleaf and determined that he is financially able to do this development. However, the issue here is whether the corporation, which is the applicant, is financially able to handle this project. The primary purpose for a single shareholder to form a corporation is to shield his personal assets from liability for corporate debt. And those are the only issues that I wish to raise.
Thank you. Are there any other comments from the public? Hearing none, I'll close the public hearing. At this time, I'd like to open up the discussion to the planning board members. Does anyone have comments, questions? Judy?
I don't really know what to do with this, but after our site walk out there and to see the large manure pile that basically touches the stone wall and the dip of the property, and reviewing this again, it just leaves me with the feeling that this is somehow one lot too big or something. I feel uncomfortable with the roadway swinging so close to the property line and the drainage easement being reduced. I'm not sure what kind of adequate buffering can be proposed in that area. As is raised in the memo, I feel somewhat uncomfortable too with the way one will approach the subdivision from the north and just see the backs of two houses with pretty much no landscaping or buffering behind them between them and the Mormon church. And I'm still very concerned with the notion of coming to the nuisance. I did ask the planner, and I don't know if she'll have any comments from our town attorney, that I would like to see some, if any is possible, some legal mechanism to protect the operation of this farm. I've seen it before in other subdivisions next to other uses that were termed noxious by people who move in, and they get the uses shut down, and I'm very sensitive to the abutters' concerns. I don't really know where to go from here, but those are very major concerns. It seems like too much, and I can certainly understand the applicant's interest in this property. I have still concerns about the fencing and the roses, although I certainly appreciate the feel you're trying to give to it. I almost have such general questions I can't ask any.
I don't know that any question is too general. If you have a question you'd like to ask, please feel free to do so. I think the issue tonight is that the applicant has admitted that the application is anticipating a tabling. Mm-hmm. An applicant is anticipating the tabling, so if there are discussions that can be brought forth at this time that would give some indication to the applicant as a direction that the board is heading in, I think this would be the appropriate time to do it.
Well, I guess one question I would throw to other board members to discuss as I go back and forth on this issue of private roadways and subdivisions. On the one hand, board certainly knows I'm very in favor of narrower roads and creating a feel of neighborhoods. On the flip side of that, though, I can appreciate where homeowners come in later to the town demanding perhaps town services. And I assume in this case, like other similar cases, they'd be told the town will not provide services, the roadway is substandard, the right-of-way is substandard. Part of me would like to see a wider right-of-way, but that conflicts what I just said with the narrow roadway and the fencing. I guess I'd like to hear if other board members have strong feelings about that. And I don't know enough, I admit it, about the economics of projects to know if a four-lot subdivision means this is a no-go and five-lot makes it happen. I'd like to hear your comments, Tom. I know they'll come last.
Anyone else? Mark?
Yes, I could address a couple of those because I've been concerned with them also. I think that the concept of a village scale and neighborhood sort of interaction and cohesiveness is something that we certainly have been talking about amongst ourselves for quite a while now. During this past weekend, or a couple weekends ago, I went through Stony Brook, which I believe has about the same width of pavement that the applicant here is proposing, and tried to imagine the combination of modern snow plowing equipment as opposed to English village horse-drawn plows and fences in straight runs, not really at right angles and braced upright as strongly as they perhaps would be otherwise, being so close to those streets that they almost tend to conflict with each other. The ideas really aren't sort of reinforcing each other. Another aspect of the subdivision that I'm more concerned with after the site walk is the buffering aspect, basically all along the parking lot to the north. When coming back to look at the plans, noticing that the property line is very close to the edge of the parking lot, probably within the moat area right now on the church, and the corner to the south, where I agree with Judy, I'm not sure that there's enough real estate there to adequately do anything on that corner that would give it some buffering with respect to the adjacent parcel.
Is that it?
There was one other item that I was wondering if I might get some clarification on from Mr. Greer. Town engineer made a general comment that the chip sealing method proposed for this project is one which is a different mixture and different proportion from ones that have been used in the past. And if you could comment on the proportions of the mix and the anticipated performance of that insulation as opposed to what we're seeing now in the newspaper about what's happening over in South Portland right now.
Sure. What you're seeing in South Portland, let me clarify, is something completely different. What you're seeing in South Portland is those roads were already paved with bituminous pavement and were then covered with chip seal paving. So what you have is a very hard surface that they sprayed with asphalt and then rolled stone on top of it. What we're proposing, and we have revised the details since the town engineer's comments, is to provide a chip seal pavement on top of gravel, where you spray the gravel and you, with the asphalt, put the stones on and roll the stone into the gravel. The gravel being a much softer medium than the paving, and therefore you get better penetration of the stone, and the asphalt will actually cover the stones completely and knit together to complete a surface. The problem with the South Portland one is that it's such a hard surface underneath that the stones are not binding to the asphalt, and therefore they're coming off the mixture. So it's two completely different processes. We have the original plans were submitted with only a single layer of chip seal. Inadvertently, there should have been two, which is similar to the previous projects that the board has looked at and approved the use of it, which I think is what his comments were leading to, is that it really needed to be a heavier duty mixture, and I think we've improved that to do that. We have changed the asphalt slightly since the 1985 project that he referred to. That's due to changes in the industry and experience over the past few years, is that the asphalt that we're changing it to is a little better at knitting the thing together and staying a little more flexible. We're looking at a flexible type pavement, which is similar to asphalt pavement versus a rigid pavement, which would be similar to concrete. So that's what we've done to rectify that comment.
Is that it? Does anyone else have any comments? Going once, twice, three times? No comments? Well, to move things along, I will just, I guess I'll hit on several things. First of all, I think certainly one board member is familiar with a development, an award-winning development in Cumberland, which is moving very slowly. And I think one of the keys to having a village development and to having it successful is to having a level of public improvement where someone has a sense of place. And that can be accomplished with the provision of public improvements, fencing, and particularly street trees, where this is an open site. I would be looking very much toward the developer providing the public amenities that provide a sense of completeness to the project, regardless of the rate of sellout of the property, and that would be street trees, buffering, and providing the fencing, or some mechanism for assuring the board that that will take place and that we'll have a unified feeling throughout the site, so that we don't have stockade fence 6 feet high in front of one house and picket fence of a different color in front of another. And I think the applicant would agree that that's crucial. If you go through Castine, although they're all separate property owners, there's a sense of unity within that village that allows those narrow streets to take place. In terms of the easement along the south property line, there was a discussion at the site walk. I want to be sure that where that easement is indicated to cross over into the abutting property, that is taken care of as part of the revised plans. I also agree that it's particularly close along that property line. Is there any reason why that right-of-way can't swing further away from the property line at that point, Tom?
If you go through the lot sizes and layout and the septic system locations, it's all very tight. And the reason it is as close as it is was originally to provide a 30-foot right-of-way, and the easements were added later. Was to provide space in here for the three septic systems, the hammerhead turnaround, and the it's where the lot narrows itself. So, and as you move it, you also change lot areas for these two lots, which are very close to the minimum. And it may be able to be moved a few feet, but very few feet. And I'm not sure that you would notice the difference once constructed, whether that would be a noticeable difference or not.
Okay. The storm drainage through that, I didn't see a comment on the engineer's report, but the storm drainage through that area is very shallow. It's certainly less than frost depth. I don't know if you are particularly aware of that or whether insulation is needed. I just raise that as a question. And our town engineer can certainly comment on that. The other thing that will be crucial, I think, because of the few, that there are only five lots here, and it's a relatively deep entrance road for five lots, or particularly three lots that are almost fronting directly upon it, is an understanding that there is an ability by a homeowners association to maintain that. Do we have a homeowners draft for maintenance requirements?
Yes, we do.
Okay. I'll look more carefully at that in the future. Another question, I know the answer, but I'll ask it anyway. Nobody in this community, particularly on this board, a few members on the board, are excited about having to provide septic systems in areas that are sewered. We know what the situation is. We know why you're providing them. However, we look for opportunities that in the future, should capacity change or should an opportunity arise, or particularly as we saw in the town center where a system may fail, and systems can fail at any time, that there's an opportunity to extend sewer. Has there been any discussions either among the team or with the town engineer or the public works director about, rather than having two separate services come from Route 77, bring a single service in along the access road and tee off to the two lots that will be served at that point, with an understanding that perhaps in the future that line could be extended to the rear lots?
I haven't personally had any discussions with those people when we've got involved with it. I believe Rick had gone through that, those discussions previously. My understanding is that there is not capacity in the system and that this lot is only allowed a certain number of hookups,
That's
which
correct.
We've taken advantage here. Your proposal to combine them two and put a stub in here that could be extended back, you're fighting grades. I don't believe that's going to work from a gravity point of view. I see that if these homes are to be connected in the future to the system, then there will certainly be a pump station involved with that, probably an individual pump station, so at which time I would see a small diameter force main coming up the edge of the right-of-way, a pressure system of sorts. And again, that could connect very easily back out into Ocean House Road.
Okay. I think I've heard some discussions about buffering of the adjacent property. I was involved in a large application before the city of South Portland back in the go-go 80s, and it extended over such a long period of time as I really got to enjoy a lot of planning board meetings and see a number of subdivisions approved, which I knew were near the treatment facility off Highland Avenue. And I kept wondering how long it would be before the applicants came back or the people who bought the houses and complained to the city about the odors that were coming from that facility. And sure enough, it's happened. I don't see any way but that won't happen in this case. And I want it, through this process, to have it clearly understood. I would like to see the farm protected as a farm, just as the applicant has not specifically all the items that she has listed. But this is a rural community, and I think one of the things that really makes it successful is we have a diversity of open areas, farms, and as was discussed in the site walk, there's probably a strong marketing advantage to having a house for a particular owner located near that farm. Contrarily, it could be a disaster for certain times during the summer. That I don't know if Ms. Dudley is still here, but the board, on the other hand, witnessed what we seem to think was probably extraordinary storage of manure, probably crossing the property line and not within state standards. And certainly, if she were an applicant today, there'd be a lot of concern about the water quality in Trout Brook because of that manure pile. So I'd like to see a happy compromise met here. I would like to see the manure handled in a way that's appropriate, meeting state standards, and we want the applicant to understand that this board is not going to be terribly sensitive to any concerns that come out of the ordinary use and existing use of that farm, as it may impact the proposed development. Yes.
Good evening. My name is Peter Greenleaf. I'm the owner of Rigos Corporation and the applicant here tonight. I have met with Mrs. Dudley and a week or so ago and reviewed her concerns and reviewed the plan with her. I at one time was a horse person myself. I had a 40-acre farm in Cumberland. I took care of 21 racehorses and I had horses of my own. I eventually sold one of my horses to Mrs. Dudley, and I guess she had her for almost 10 years and just recently gave her back to the person I bought her from so that the horse could go out to pasture. I am not offended by horse farms. I've lived on one. I've ridden horses since I was a kid, and as I wrote a letter to Mrs. Dudley explaining that there was no intent on my part to condemn her farm, to reduce its operation, or to anywhere way impair it. I consider it an asset. There are a number of people around who like to ride horses. And to live proximate to a place where you could go take lessons or ride would be an asset for some people. It would be my intent that any lots that are sold would be clearly sold with the description that it's adjacent to the farm, and that there are horses there. Now, I cannot stand here tonight, though, and guarantee that someone down the road is not going to complain. There's no, I mean, I couldn't guarantee it, no one can guarantee it, so I don't know what we do about that. As to, I'm concerned about, when we talk about buffering, if you, from the, when we're talking of, and we went through the site walk, the farm is quite a bit elevated above the location, and any buffering, it seems to me, would be looking into the side of either the manure pile or the hill, by and large. There is some buffering there, natural buffering in trees and shrubs. And to the extent that we could save them, we will. We don't want to cut them down. You can't replace trees that are at any size. And they're an asset to the lots, and they're an asset to keep the to keep a buffer. But building fences of a dimension along the Connecticut Turnpike, that would be an eyesore to my way of thinking, mm-hmm. for everybody. And I would be concerned about activities which would scare horses. I know that they can be scared, but quite frankly, when you have a farm, as I did, I was driving tractors in and out of there all the time. I don't know what kind of activities are going to dramatically affect horses. And I know Mrs. Dudley has a large investment. She has a good operation. She's a reputable and recognized horse person. And as I say, I don't want to do anything that would impair her stable. But I think that the realities here are that two house lots abutting her property are not going to adversely impact it. If you have any questions of me while I'm here tonight.
Do any of the board members have a question? Go ahead, Mr. Marvin.
I'm concerned about having curb cuts onto Ocean House Road as opposed to Wild Rose for lots 1 and 2.
I didn't catch the first part of what you said.
Are you planning to have curb cuts onto Ocean House Road for lots 1 and 2?
No, we're not.
Those will all be accessed right off Wild Rose Path.
Okay, my misunderstanding.
We can add a note to that effect to make sure that that happens.
If I can, Tom, just go back and maybe talk a little bit more about the buffering and some of the comments that were raised. What we have done as part of the next submittal will be to give dimensions on fences and a minimum amount of fencing that will be installed along the Wild Rose Path, as well as at the back of these two parcels here, which abut the church. And you can see that we've highlighted them here. What we're specifying is a length that visually you can see here, it's scaled off and specified. And also at the end of the fences, this will be a 6-foot high lattice fence. At the end of the fence, we'll have 3 evergreens to set the fence off, which will also provide some buffering, and those will grow in size. We don't want to put a solid buffer along this whole boundary here, feeling that that's not consistent with the neighborhoods in general, that you're creating an island here. What we're trying to do here is provide buffer, which will provide generally where the private space is behind the homes to the more public areas, which will be the church parking lot in here. I think that's a good compromise. If you drive along Route 77 and you look at the homes as you drive along, you can see that there are short sections of fences, this small individual plantings of trees. Those look very natural and fit in with the neighborhood, whereas when you come to a house that has all large pine trees in front of it, you can't see any of it. It does some screening, but I don't think it fits in with the overall neighborhood effect that we're looking to get. Kind of makes you want to kind of peek around. What are they doing back there they shouldn't be doing? I guess I would hate to see the board push so hard for buffering along this edge that we lose the opportunity to create some individual spaces that are nice and end up with double rows of pine that I don't think in the long run really benefit the neighborhood.
Do any of the board members have comment regarding that? I don't disagree, Tom. A lot of times people want pines along a public way and it looks like there's a scrap yard on the other side. There are trees already planted along the church property And I think using those as sort of a, as a foreground to the buffering and using clustering of trees and the fence combined, being assured that the fence will stay up if there's shallow bedrock, if there's a need to return the fence a little bit or brace it, whatever it takes, just to be sure that we don't end up with a wavy situation there. But I, for one, would be willing to look at alternatives other than just a solid line of evergreen trees.
You'll note this plan may not depict it as well, but right in here in this corner, which is I think one of the comments on the sewer comments was to protect the trees. This corner right in here has several large trees, and we intend to keep those. So those, although are not shown on the plan, those exist. And the note for the sewer to avoid those trees is placed there. And I would look that to be buffering this first house as you come by. I believe it's a maple there that's in the corner that's probably a 6 or 8 inch diameter that is leafed out very low because of the growing in the open, and I would assume that one would be maintained.
Let me ask you one other question while I'm thinking of it. The power is proposed to be overhead. Could you explain to the board why you've elected to use overhead rather than underground power?
As much as I hate to put this in the realm of affordable homes, we're looking to keep the home prices in this neighborhood as reasonable as possible, given the overall considerations of land values in Cape Elizabeth and trying to fit in with a quality neighborhood, and felt that that was appropriate. It does avoid some costs, and it also avoids some blasting in order to get through this first section of the road.
My immediate impression is that it's something that I don't really see is really adding much to the development, particularly depending upon the time that it's going to take to build it out. If the lots stand empty for some length of time, because it's an open field, and they'll be very noticeable. And in some cases, there's a long expanse of power line crossing over the curvature in the road. Even if you were to bring in underground to a riser pole further back into the property as a compromise, I'd leave that up to further board discussion, but I would very much like to see it brought in underground as far as possible, particularly if you can, you're dealing primarily with primary cable as the initial cost, which is not as expensive as the secondary connections to the houses.
We'll consider
it. And I guess you broached the project, and when Mr. Weinschenk came in with the original sketches, there was much discussion about affordable housing. I took the opportunity this week to look at the houses that are being built in South Portland. I don't remember the name of the street, but further down, again, the reasonably large shingle-style houses, which would appear to fit on these lots. I don't for a minute think that that's in the range of affordable housing as we typically think of it. I'd like your comment on whether or not that's what we're going to be seeing here in terms of either style or scale.
I don't recall exactly what the Portland municipal area median income retail sale price is. I believe it's $139,000, as published by Council of Governments and whoever else. And that is within a few thousand dollars the prices of those two houses on Spear Avenue in South Portland. And that is the style that we hope to see grow onto this land. There is overhead power there. I don't know whether you noticed it or not. And overhead power, I think, is something that is very, very typical to this quality of neighborhood that we're trying to create here. We're not trying to have what will be considered an upscale neighborhood. We're trying to have a neighborhood that is absolutely as affordable as possible, and adding only to that criteria some degree of design so that they aren't just five little boxes on five little lots. But I guess, again, to just answer your question, those houses that you saw could very well end up being reused in on the site.
Well, that's an exciting thought. The difference is, of course, that street already has mature street trees on it, and the lines disappear into the sky within the trees, whereas here you're in an open field where the lines would almost be the only thing that one would see, and again, depending upon the build-out. It's a point for board decision. I'm not going to, as a single planning board member, chastise a project one way or the other. It's a concern that I have, and I think it warrants board discussion.
Is there any other questions I can answer?
Go ahead, Judy.
I just wanted to address the buffering issue. I think it was Mr. Greer spoke to the idea of having, you know, evergreens along Route 77. When I was envisioning additional buffering, it would not be along 77. I keep thinking as you drive through and you go past the Mormon Church, you have a clear shot through their parking lot up into this property. And not having any trees or mature vegetation on here, I probably don't have a completely accurate memory of the property, but I seem to remember lots 1 and 3 being pretty wide open. And I guess what I don't want to see, even though these houses sound much nicer, is something, I believe it's off of Fog Road in Scarborough, the old pumpkin fields that have a number of capes with absolutely no definition between them. It's right near where you hit Pleasant Hill. And maybe other people's backyards are not like mine, but mine is something that I don't want most people to see. And lots 1 and 3, especially lot 1, would have such a clear view of any rusty swing sets, swimming pools, laundry like we have in our own yard. And I don't think a small section of lattice fencing with primarily roses along it will do much to shield the view from 77. I'd look for more, and I agree with Tom that a dense evergreen buffer often looks so contrived I'd rather see nothing, but I think there's some median point there to do something interesting yet provide privacy for both the abutters and some screening for the people going down 77. And I didn't clarify my comment about saying this seemed like one lot too big. I'm well aware that to do any realignment of the right-of-way puts lots 1 and 3 under 20,000 square foot lots, in which case the lots couldn't be built. I would be very interested to see if there's any way this project could work swinging that roadway to the north, in which case I guess lot 2 would become larger, lots 1 and 3 would be combined. It would give you many more opportunities for buffering between the farm and this property. And I would like to hear from Maureen if there is anything our town attorney has suggested with respect to coming to the nuisance, because I think we were in the vicinity of lot 3 and the wind turned the right way and it smelled, and that wasn't in hot weather. And I can, I've said only things to support the farm owner, but I do realize that this is private property, and if this is allowed, I really do support development of it, and I do not think that a property owner can be completely controlled by an abutter, so don't get me wrong in my comments. I'm just very sensitive to this notion. I'm very aware of the subdivisions Tom mentioned in South Portland, and it was an issue all along of the proximity to the sewer plant and the smells. The health issue wasn't really discussed at that point, but smells were, and all sorts of assurances were made by the developer, and lo and behold, the plant shut down. So I would like to hear if our town attorney has recommendations, and I'd like to see the best proposal in some sort of legal language, whether that will be attached to plans or put in deeds, stating how you think the property owners will be notified as to the presence of the horse farm and what that entails.
I did do some research on how we could resolve the issue of possible conflicting uses adjacent to each other. I talked to the Soil and Water Conservation Service. They suggested that the horse farm owner may want to consider approaching them about putting together a plan, and that once a plan was in place that showed the farm in use and was being managed in an appropriate way, that that would give them some standing in terms of any potential conflicts in the future. I also talked to someone with the State Department of Agriculture, and we talked about some kind of restrictions on on future property owners. And that seems to be the only approach that we know of right now. He did mention the adjacent development law for agricultural uses, which requires a 100-foot buffer zone, but that's only for farms that are registered if they have pesticides in use. So that's just a reference for the board. The only other thing that is being done that I've been able to find so far is some communities have taken a proactive stance in terms of zoning and put in agricultural protection zoning in place. But right now, it looks like perhaps the applicant could come forward with some kind of a draft of language that could be incorporated into the subdivision approval that would put the future lot owners on notice and also in some way restrict the kind of complaints that they could make as long as the farm is being managed in an appropriate manner.
Do you know from your research or from the town attorney whether legal notice on a subdivision plat or requiring something in future deeds does in fact provide legal protection, assuming proper management practices on the farm?
You mean an existing situation where that has worked?
Yes.
I haven't found anything in what I've in the research I've done so far.
Any other comments?
For now.
I'd like to make a follow-up comment as to the north side buffering with the fences. I think the judgment call there, I think, in terms of the effectiveness of the buffering and it being something that's natural and fits in and promotes a sense of community and not something that's walled off is something that is an excellent concept to achieve. On the other hand, individual sections of fence could almost take on the character of small billboards, particularly if they're unrelieved and are flanked with just a couple trees at each end. So I think in terms of something that sort of emphasizes plantings as natural buffers in addition to fencing is a good idea. And near the hammerhead on the south side of the road, would it be possible to see a larger scale drawing of how the contours are working and where the existing vegetation will leave off and the clearing for the road begin at that tight corner? Is that something that...
Is there a reading here?
Yeah, right in the tight corner, I think there's been some discussion that just assumes that the clearing operation for the road will go all the way to the lot line. And at 1 inch equals 40 feet, it's kind of hard to see exactly what's happening.
You can see on C1 the road plan profile where the contours are shown that, indeed, you're correct, that we will be very, very close to the boundary line along that section in order to get the drainage in. What we've done in order to minimize that impact is put that pipe in relatively shallow to keep the excavation down, the depth down. Obviously, that impacts the width of the trench. We have also super elevated the road through that curve to bring that side of the road up as much as possible so that you aren't cutting. And if you take a look at the 76 contour on the drawing, you'll see that it matches in very, very close to the 76 contour that's there, so that the amount of actual change in grade there is actually only a very few inches in an upwards direction. There is a little bit of cut as you work back towards 78 and 80. You'll see that there is a little bit of a cut in that direction. I think what we've tried to do there, again, is match those existing grades as much as possible with that upper side of the road. So that, yes, we will be working right up to the boundary line. I don't anticipate that once we're done that's going to be, you know, a large steep embankment or that type of look to it.
Tom, would it be possible, I think, just to give some of the board members a better feeling? This is all on computer, I assume.
Yes.
Could you just plot a larger scale of this area. You can use the same information.
Yes.
Until we determine we need anything more than that. But I think that would be helpful. Probably 1 inch equals 10 feet or 20 feet, whatever makes sense there. We did have some public comments that I think I'd like to hear the applicant at least address. One is the issue of blasting. I believe you've covered that in your correspondence, but could you just discuss briefly again for the record the issue of blasting and how the abutter will be appeased with that whole issue?
Yes. First of all, if allowed onto the abutter's property, we'll do a pre-blast survey as part of the blasting procedures. In that pre-blast survey, generally they go in and videotape or take pictures of any areas that are either currently damaged or may be susceptible to damage along foundation walls and that type of thing, so that you can get a visual image of what's going on. That is kind of a protective measure that at least if damage does occur, you can have a better assurance that the guilty party can be found and that there is no claims that are up in the air that you can't tell one way or the other whether there's an actual claim. That doesn't do a whole lot to assure the abutters that damage won't occur. What we have to do is take it another step further. What we've proposed to do is notify the farm that 48 hours prior to any blasting, that they'll be notified that blasting will occur, so that there is some opportunity for them that if there is a sensitive animal that needs to be either moved or handled properly, put in a separate area, that type of thing, that they have that opportunity to do so. Generally, what you do as part of a blasting program is you limit particle velocities, which is the wave that transmits through the rock, which again is, if you look at the blast, it creates a wave in the rock, which actually creates the damage. You limit that velocity in order to minimize damage. And what we'll do is set up meters at the boundary line and limit that particle velocity to less than an acceptable range that doesn't cause damage. We'll also obviously be using a licensed blaster professional in doing it. I see it, most of it limited to this first, roughly where the knoll cuts across, roughly 100 feet in, there's a section there. We'll attempt to do the blasting all in one period of time so that you don't have blasting for the water line and then come back and blast for the road as well. We'll try to get all of it in one particular time frame, which I think will minimize any inconvenience. We are still left with the construction of the homes. I guess that's where I would see maybe some additional words that need to be placed in the record that says that those same concerns are still there. Just because the road and utilities are all in, blasting still becomes a concern. We aren't sure whether they're going to require blasting for the homes yet or not. Lot 2,